I'm this guy, and this talk should serve as a brief introduction to the use of mathematical notation as a language. I'm going to preface this talk by saying that I suffer from what's known as the curse of knowledge, where I've been working with this stuff for so long that I really don't remember what problems I had when I started. And as such, I don't know what problems most people have when they start. My co-workers are familiar with this stuff, if not because I introduced them to it, which is the case for some of them. But if I'm going too fast or too slow for you, then please tell me in the comments. That would help a lot. Again, on this guy, I'm an intelligence analyst. I'm not a computer programmer, which is a fairly common misconception I've noticed for people online. You can only assume this is the case because I know a few programming languages, as well as just general stuff about computers and whatnot. But although I use that stuff on a day-to-day basis, I'm not a computer programmer, at least I don't really identify, I guess you could say, with that term. Back onto my job, I can only answer a few questions regarding that due to the nature of the job. It's a bit secretive. But if you have a question and you'd like me to answer it, then ask it. I can always say, you know, sorry, I can't answer that. I have a fairly diverse set of skills, and the first one I've listed here is mathematics, which should, for obvious reasons, be relevant here. Please do not feel bad if you can't add numbers or do other low-level things. I can't either. My interest really started to flourish in the sixth grade when I started diving into calculus and similar subjects. After I started doing stuff with graphs on the terminal I had at the time, you know, I understand the concepts well. And I can apply these. I can write functions. I can solve problems using mathematics. I just can't do the arithmetic myself. So, really my thoughts about this can be summarized as computers were made for a reason. Which is true. The first computers were literally made to perform tedious tasks more quickly than humans could perform these tasks. As I've mentioned, although I'm not a computer programmer, one of my skills is computer programming. In particular, my favorite language would probably be C++, because I'm most familiar with that. But Haskell might be a close second, because its syntax is fairly similar to just standard mathematical notation, and I'm most familiar with that. Anyway, the computer programming bit here is relevant, because computer programming effectively obsoletes doing low to mid-level mathematical tasks, like adding things and whatnot, finding averages. And I can host some pretty kick-ass parties near Thanksgiving. In the past, we've had a guy raised his hand above the table, just smashed an egg on the table. That was fun. I had to clean that up. In retrospect, I probably should have made him do it. I'll just hit him with my baton here until he did. But I'd say I'm gonna kick your ass first. We also had a guy brought a Roomba, I think it was last year. The thing ended up smashed. Yeah. I think this was also last year. We took a battery out and blew it up. turn into a nice fireball. Anyway, on to the meat and potatoes of this talk. What is mathematical notation? Mathematical notation was created by mathematicians to describe concepts amongst themselves in detail and with great specificity. Mathematical notation is different from what I call the human languages, which include English and Lajban, arguably. One of those differences is the simplicity. You don't have adverbs, you don't have adjectives, you don't have anything like that. And something which I think is particularly interesting is there's really no way to speak mathematical notation. It's essentially purely a written thing. Something important to note here is that mathematical notation is not limited to numbers. It can describe a hell of a lot more than that. Of course, mathematics isn't really limited to numbers either, because logic is arguably a subdiscipline of mathematics. And logic just deals with logical consequences. Right, so why would anyone want to understand mathematical notation? One of the first things I've listed here is extreme precision. Due to the nature of mathematics, precision is imperative here. One of the ways this manifests is in the lack of homonyms. Mathematics has no homonyms or anything like that. We also have extreme terseness, where, somewhat amusingly, I actually haven't placed a bullet point here. So, let's just assume that I did that intentionally, okay? as a joke. Something else kind of neat is variables and functions are locally defined. This also contributes to terseness, whereas English formally uses global definitions, which are written in dictionaries, as opposed to beginning documents with, this variable refers to this, this contains the set of so-and-so. The use of mathematical notation can also facilitate analytical thought by being really extremely dry and removing loaded words, as well as, arguably more importantly, dissecting arguments such that arguments can be very easily followed, and you can say, I disagree that this implies this. I don't think that's accurate. However, even though mathematical notation is extremely dry, a bit of humor is still possible. In the forms of surreal humor, just being kind of weirdly verbose about things, and stating the obvious, I think, can sometimes be funny. Like, there exists a number. QED. There's your obvious thing. Anyway, here's an example of a better joke, where to properly appreciate this, you have to have some understanding of calculus and derivatives. Delta over delta x-ray is a, I should say Latin delta over Latin delta x-ray is a common way of writing derivatives. But it's not saying that Latin delta is multiplied by x-ray. That's just a, that's just standard format. So this, the answer here is correct, but the process is hot garbage. That's the best way to put that. Disadvantage is mathematical notation. As I've previously mentioned, mathematical notation cannot be directly spoken. As such, to verbally, or to communicate these ideas in speech, you have to convert them to one of the so-called human languages. Another thing is that it's not very readable for the uninitiated, I guess is the right word here. But, as I've mentioned, maybe this video can be of use. And I hope it is. I also don't have any global definitions, which means that you really need to read the definitions at the beginning of each paper. You need to read your style guides to see if any global definitions have been specified in there. Also, typographical errors are really, really bad here, because variable names tend to be fairly short. So you might not be able to say, oh, I can tell this is referring to that. Okay, it's referring to this. And you end up making a wrong decision based upon that assumption there. Again, bad. Let's move on to discussing the grammar of mathematical notation, beginning with the so-called atoms, which I just called because I wasn't sure what other word I'd use. Sorry about that. And that. Alright. In nouns, you have literals, which are just plainly stated numbers. 2 and 3 decimal, 1 4. We also have variables, like pi, Euler's constant, and asshat, which refers to the constant number of, no, I think that's the ratio of asshats to reasonable men at any given time. I'd like to mention here that multi-character variable names are valid, regardless of what your math teachers in schools taught you. You can also use functions and operators as nouns. Like, you can take root 2 and x-ray of Yankee and add that to something if you want to, thereby using that as a noun. And also, anything contained within parentheses is converted to a noun, and really, if you want to simplify this, you can just say any expression is a noun. Verbs. You have, what I call indicators, because there doesn't really seem to be any standard term for these. These include the logical connectives and the declarations, like the equal sign, and that little arrow there, which we're going to go over in a bit. We also have functions. And yes, these can act as verbs. They can act as nouns or verbs. So, here, you have the case of x-ray of Yankee. And that is the sentence. Essentially, this is converted to X-ray of Yankee is true. If you want to know why that functions as a sentence, in mathematical notation, or speaking of mathematical notation, as well as in English, sentences must contain a verb and a noun. They also need to express some sort of idea. And a good way when you're starting out writing this stuff, is, you know, for every sentence you try to write, you think, can this be literally translated to a proper sentence in English? And if it can't, then you need to rewrite that to be more clear. Here we see some examples of sentences. And here we see some examples of nonsenses. And some really shit jokes. So that's always nice. Now moving on to punctuation. Full stops are used to end all statements. Just like in English. Well, I shouldn't say just like in English, because in English you also have exclamation marks, which mathematical notation does not use in the same way. You also have question marks, which I should mention here, question marks in mathematical notation are not a standard. At least they're not a worldwide standard. Question marks can be used to indicate uncertainty, or they can be used in place of a noun to request. That someone fills in that noun. As I've mentioned, exclamation marks are not, I repeat, not used as they are in English. Exclamation marks are used for factorials, and there's a huge difference there. I'll just say that the reason for this is that additional usage of exclamation marks would probably be a bit confusing. Let's discuss questions in more detail. As I've mentioned, these are not completely accepted by the mathematical community. Some people think that, you know, you should write questions as questions in English or whatever. I disagree with that, because I think that English bogs things down. I actually wrote the portion of a style guide which deals with this for work within my little organizational unit. I offered that. So I know a little bit about this. Here are some examples of questions. You can say here, does X-ray imply Yankee? Or, what implies Yankee? Respectively. Let's take a look at some of the more commonly used symbols in mathematical notation. Beginning with this little right-facing arrow I showed you earlier, this is used for implication. Essentially, alpha right arrow bravo is semantically equivalent to if alpha, then bravo. You can really just think about it as being that. But personally, I prefer the term implies. The left-facing arrow is semantically equivalent to only if. The example here is alpha only if bravo is semantically equivalent to if bravo then alpha. And I apparently made a typo, so that's nice. The third symbol we have on this list is if and only if, or if. This doesn't really have a native equivalent in English. So the best way I could really write this. It's semantically equivalent to stating that Alpha implies Bravo, and Bravo implies Alpha. We also have some more logical symbols. This first one, that little backwards, majuscule echo-looking thing, is semantically equivalent to there exists, which is often used in statements like there exists a number such that this number is equal to the square root of 1. That's a fairly stupid example, but it's a decent overview. The next symbol we see these were actually two symbols. You know, just use whichever one you prefer. But each of these is semantically equivalent to such that, which does exactly what it sounds like. We have the three dots with the one on top, which is semantically equivalent to therefore, which is used the same way therefore is used in English. However, a comma does not follow this symbol. Next symbol is because, which, you know, three dots with one below, and this is semantically equivalent to because. This often joins two expressions. We have and, which looks like a lambda character. That is just semantically equivalent to and. It's that simple. Or, the next symbol is semantically equivalent to or in English. The next symbol I think is particularly useful because English has no equivalent. That would be ZOR, or exclusive OR. Really the best way to describe that is one or the other, but not both. And use that just in place of OR, if it applies. If not, that, not sure how I'd describe that to you. That just, says that whatever argument you give it is false. So here, the example I've given says that not, the sum of 1 and 2 is equal to the difference of 1 and 2. We also have this upside-down majuscule alpha, which is semantically equivalent to for all. And the example I've written here is translated as for all complex numbers, the sum of a complex number in itself is not equal, or for all complex numbers, the sum of a complex number in 1 is not equal to this complex number. Which is, it's true. Go ahead, try to find an exception to that. We have some stuff here for sequences and sets, which we'll discuss later in this talk. This first symbol here, my god, I've had my mouse pointer on the screen this whole time. Yeah, this first symbol here is, says that, you know, its first argument is, an element of its second argument. You know, it's in a set. That's all it says. It's important to note, this is not semantically equivalent to the equal sign, because equality statements are bidirectional, and this is not bidirectional. You cannot say that a set is an element of a number, because that's wrong. We have the next two symbols, which that's subset of and subset of are equal to. Where for all sets alpha, for all sets bravo, Alpha is a subset of Bravo, if and only if, for all elements which are contained within Alpha, an element is contained within Bravo. The next symbol here is cardinality, which is particularly interesting because you start to study this. This is where you get into the sizes of infinities. An example here is, you know, take a set alpha. The cardinality of set alpha answers the question, how many elements does set alpha contain? The next thing here, I probably could have notated this a bit better, but, you know, you have the name of a set, and then in a subscript, you have a number which refers to the, position of the element of the set which you wish to access. And so I have set union, which, the union of two sets is the set which contains the elements of Alpha and the elements of Bravo. We also have set intersection, which returns the elements which are in Alpha and Bravo. As in my example here, we have the set difference, where for all sets Alpha, for all sets Bravo, the set difference of Alpha and Bravo is equal to the set which contains the elements of Alpha which are not in set Bravo. The equality operator is misunderstood way too often. And as a result of this, arguments suffer and accuracy suffers. The most important thing to note here is, both sides of the equal sign are equal. So you can just flip your equality statement and it should still be correct. I say it's misunderstood. I'd like to back that up by giving an example here of proper usage. You tell someone to write, or to show work for calculating the sum of the numbers 1 through 5. And it might show something like this. 1 plus 2 is equal to 3. Plus 3 is equal to 6. Plus 4 is equal to 10. Plus 5 is equal to 15. That is wrong. That is very wrong, because the sum of 1 and 2, which is 3, is not equal to the sum of 3 and 3, which is 6. So please, for the love of God, do not write things like that. If you write things like that, then I will track you down in the middle of the night, and I will slap you. I will slap you, and I will scream at you, and I will give you a lecture regarding this, and I will call you a goddamn Nimrod or something. Because, I don't know, I don't have any patience for incompetence. On to the relatively advanced stuff. You might be thinking,
already?
But, you know, the nice things about recordings is, if you don't understand anything here, anything I've discussed previously, or anything discussed in this relatively advanced stuff, then you can go to Wolfram Math World. You can look up that topic and say, oh, I understand that now. And you can come back here later and use this, you can go somewhere in this talk. And go back where you stopped. Oh, I get it now. That makes sense. Anyway, moving on. Functions. What are functions? I remember that in my math classes throughout school, the teachers often made it sound like functions just operate on numbers. That is not true, as I will discuss in a little bit. A function is just something which maps an input to an output. It can be thought of as performing an action. As a result of this loose definition, functions are extremely versatile. You can really describe just about anything using a function. They can operate on numbers, Boolean values, that's true, false, sets. You might even be able to do something with Cornish game hens, if you really want to. God knows why. Here's an example, which I pluralized for some reason. Let's take a color, or let's take a function color, which maps an object to a sequence. For all objects Oscar, the color of an object Oscar is equal to color of object Oscar. Now this definition sucks, because I wasn't really sure about how I'd go about saying, return the hex code, because what do you do for multicolored things? So I'll just leave figuring that out as an exercise to the reader in traditional mathematical form. Piecewise function definitions. Piecewise definitions declare functions by specifically outlining the function outputs by the inputs which are given. As with other functions, these support any sort of input. And if you have any kind of background in computer science or programming, then you're going to know these as if statements. Here we see absolute value defined in the form of a piecewise function. For all real numbers x-ray, the absolute value of a number x-ray is equal to x-ray if x-ray is greater than or equal to 0, and negative x-ray if x-ray is less than 0. On to sets. I use sets a lot. I think this is another case of most problems can be solved using these, because they're inherently very versatile. Sets do not just support numbers, but we'll get to that. Sets, in essence, can be described as unordered lists. And are denoted by curly brackets. Sets can contain zero elements, or be uncountably infinite. This is where that cardinality thing I mentioned earlier comes into play. Sets are really useful whenever you're dealing with multiple things at a time. See, for all elements in the set, this applies. As I mentioned, sets can contain quite literally anything, even things which have never existed, as well as things which never will exist, never could exist. Sets can be clearly defined, as in the case of set Alpha contains Macaulay Culkin and Saddam Hussein. Again, I'll leave figure out whatever function to return those two, and only those two, as an exercise to the reader. Or, this is really cool, you can use set builder notation. Set builder notation generates a set which matches the conditions which written in set builder notation. Set builder notation can return a null set or an infinite set. It is extremely useful when working with infinite sets, for example, primes, because primes are infinite. You can say, here's the definition of prime numbers. Everything in the set builder notation defined thing. The same thing applies to sequences, which we'll look at now. Sequences are essentially just ordered sets, and are denoted by parentheses or angle brackets. Personally, I prefer the use of angle brackets because I like using parentheses just for grouping. I find that that's a bit less confusing. And, really, sequences are where accessing individual elements via this little subscript notation is useful. I apologize for the little typo here. Guess I didn't notice that. Let's look at some examples of set builder notation. Let's say that x-ray squared is equal to 1. This means that x-ray is equal to the element, or is an element of the set, which contains element Yankee, if and only if Yankee squared is equal to 1. Which is true if and only if x-ray is in negative 1, 1. However, you can also be a lot less, I'm not even sure where I was going with this. maybe my point here was, you can be a bit more abstract. You can say that set alpha is defined as containing all green apples, or all apples, such that the color of this apple is green. This set contains all green apples which have ever existed, which do exist, which ever will exist. God knows why I'd want to do anything with that, but I'm not telling you how to live your life. Yeah, here's an example of using set builder notation to build a sequence. This just generates the sequence of all primes. Let's move on to use cases. Here's a title slide I apparently forgot. Why would you want to use mathematical notation in arguments? As we've already mentioned, mathematical notation is easily dissected, which facilitates checking for errors to ensure that you don't look like a dumbass when you go to argue. And arguing against these arguments becomes fairly easy due to being able to dissect these arguments and say, I don't agree with this bit. Also, specificity is nice, because then you don't end up arguing over semantics. Here we have an example. I'll let you look at this for a bit, and I'm going to read it. This is another mathematical joke, where in this case, this is read as, for all men, that a man is knowledgeable implies that this man is powerful. For all men, that a man is powerful implies that this man is corrupt. Therefore, for all men, that a man is knowledgeable implies that this man is corrupt. You can also use mathematical notation in general communication, because when used properly, mathematical notation can reduce communication via clarity and simplicity, terseness, as well as saving time also by terseness. It may encourage thinking about stuff objectively, because you don't have loaded words, as we've already mentioned, and something else. Mathematical notation is easily translated to other languages because mathematical notation is the same in every other language. As such, only your definitions need to be translated. You end up saving yourself a lot of time translating things. You might not even need to hire a translator. You can just get a textbook on whatever language you're doing and go from there. So, for an example here, please refer to the example for the use of mathematical notation in logical arguments. Both things end up looking fairly similar. Again, traditional mathematical fashion. Refer to this. I'd like to end this talk by saying that, again, this is not comprehensive. If you are interested in this, then please, for the love of God, look further. Or, if you'd like to have me add some resources to the description, write that in the comments and I can do that. Hopefully at least one of these things applies. I've spiked your interest in mathematics. We'll go with that. And maybe I've even encouraged a better structuring of your arguments, or your sentences in general. I'd also like to say that recommendations for future videos, as well as just criticisms of this talk, are very much welcomed. And that's about it.